Folks, I want you to stand. I want you to stand to your feet. I want you to stand. We've been talking about all in the family. All in the family. Now, this guy Solomon wrote 1,005 songs. 1,005 songs. Now, God in his sovereignty allowed one of them to be in the Word of God. It's the Song of Solomon. I've written a song. I've pitched it to some country music stars. Hadn't gotten traction yet, but I have written a song. The title of the song is, You Can Put Me in Prison, But You Can't Keep My Face from Breaking Out. Amen? That's not done so well. But anyway, let's see what the Bible says. If thou know not, O thou fairest among women, go thy way forth by the footsteps of the flock and feed thy kids beside the shepherd's tents. I have compared thee, O my love, to a company of horses in Pharaoh's chariots. I have compared thee, O my love, to a company of horses in Pharaoh's chariots. Let us pray. Jesus, I pray that you would speak to us and through us. I pray that you would meet the needs of your precious people. And for all you do, we just want to give you glory, honor, and praise. Believe in you for a tremendous, tremendous day. And I pray all this in Christ's name. Amen. You may be seated. I want to talk to you today, being Valentine's Day. Valentine's Day. I want to talk to you about how to keep your Valentine for a lifetime. How to keep your Valentine for a lifetime. Now, I started studying about Valentine and Valentine's Day. It was very interesting. There were several traditional things about Valentine's Day. One was, it's believed that if you met your mate on Valentine's Day, the relationship would last for a lifetime. So perhaps that's the secret. You've got to meet on Valentine's Day. You've got to meet on February the 14th. But then I researched it more, and I found out on Valentine's Eve, you had to do some things. First of all, they believed in order to meet your mate on Valentine's Day, on Valentine's Eve, you had to sleep with leaves pinned to your pillow. You had to sleep with leaves pinned to your pillow, and then on Valentine's Eve, you had to eat 5 hard-boiled eggs. And if you had leaves pinned to your pillow and you ate 5 hard-boiled eggs, you were destined on Valentine's Day to meet Mr. Wright or Mrs. Wright. But then I did a little more research, and I found out there was a priest named Valentinus. The priest named Valentinus who helped Christians in the 3rd century when they were persecuted by the Roman government. And I found out this priest by the name of Valentinus who helped Christians was put in prison. And while he was in prison, the jailer's daughter was a blind girl. And she would bring him food. And they fell in love. And it was said that Valentinus prayed for her. And she received her sight. And they said to him, if you'll denounce Christianity, you can live. And he said, no, I'm not going to denounce Christianity. And on the way to be executed, he handed his love a note. And the note said, from your Valentine. From your Valentine. Right before he was executed. And that's how we came up with Valentine's card. It came from the priest, Valentinus. Well, nevertheless, he loved to the end. Now, I'm not so sure about those stories. Perhaps they're true, perhaps they're not true. It was just in my research. But I know the story that we're studying about today is true because it's God's word. And God's word is true. And folks, we just line up with what God's word says. And the story today is about a relationship. It's about a relationship with King Solomon and his bride, actually his very first bride. It was about his very first wedding. And let me tell you, folks, we have to make the best of the situations we're in. But I think there's a lot we can learn from Solomon and Shulamite. She was a lady from northern Israel, from a place called Shunem. And as I study the story of Solomon and Shulamite, I notice a big part of this song is just about communication. It's just about Solomon communicating with her. And it's just about her communicating with him. I heard about an old farmer who goes down to the courthouse and he says, I want to get a divorce. And the judge says, you do. The farmer says, yes. And the judge says, well, do you have grounds? He said, yeah, we got about 100 acres. He said, no. He said, I'm not talking about that. He said, does either one of you have a grudge? He said, yeah, we do. He said, that's where I keep the tractor. He said, no. That's a garage. He said, I'm trying to figure out problems. He said, by chance, is this relationship, has it gotten physical? Do you beat her up? And the old farmer said, no. She gets up before I do. But the old farmer said, Judge, she keeps saying we can't communicate. She keeps saying we can't communicate. Do you know 80% of marital problems, 80% of marital problems can be traced back to poor communication? 80%, I'm not a marriage counselor, but did you know marriage counselors say that 90% of marriage counseling is an attempt to restore communication? 90% of marriage counseling is just an attempt to restore communication. Now listen to this. This blew my mind. I've been doing some study. The average married couple communicates 1 hour a week. Now wait, this is where it blows my mind. The average married couple communicates 1 hour a week. But listen to this. The average couple having an affair communicates 10 hours every week. The average married couple communicates 1 hour each week, but the average couple having an affair communicates 10 hours each week. And folks, by the way, this seems so simple. This seems so simple, but I think it's something that people need to work on. You said, Pastor Benny, you've got it down. No, I don't have it down. I remember one time Barbara and I were driving down the road, and I never will forget this. It was a news flash for me. She said, would you like to stop and get something to drink? I said, no, I'm fine. And listen to me closely. About 30 minutes later, I realized she wasn't fine. Amen? Some of you been there and done that. Amen? See, you don't listen to just what they say. You got to listen to between what they say. Amen? You got to listen to what they're not saying, because many times they don't really say what they want to say. You just got to read between the lines. One man lived to be 100 years old. 100 years old. 100 years old. And was married for 75 years. Can you imagine, 100 years old, married for 75 years? And they asked him, they said, how did you make it? How did you make it to 100 years old and 75 years of marriage? He said, well, when we first got married, we decided if we got into a fuss, the one who was wrong would go outside and go for a walk. And he said, I've walked every day for 75 years. Now here, nothing today is going to be deep. Nothing today is going to be deep. But I'll promise you this, if you would take what Solomon and Shulamite teaches us today and you would apply it to your lives, you would leave and say, our family's better. Our marriage is better. We're better because we followed not what Benny Tate said, but we followed what God's word said. We'll be better because simply we just did what God's word said. Not what any preacher, not what any psychologist, not what anybody else said. We just followed what God's word said. Let me give you three simple things that are woven into the word of God. Number one, be personal with praise. Be personal with praise. I have a close friend. He's a close friend in my life, and he's a mentor in my life. And to be honest with you, I knew him. The reason why he's a close friend and is a mentor, I knew him before he had bookshelves at Barnes & Noble. His name's John Maxwell. John Maxwell's been a mentor in my life, and John Maxwell taught me a principle many, many years ago. It's called the 30-second rule. It's called the 30-second rule. And this is what the 30-second rule teaches. He says, when you first meet somebody, within the first 30 seconds, look for something to compliment them on. It's called the 30-second rule. When you first meet somebody, within the first 30 seconds, you look for something to compliment them on or about or whatever. And you know, I read that and I thought that's a wonderful principle. But I thought, wouldn't that be so great if we would apply that to our marriages? Wouldn't it be so great if we would simply be personal with praise? Now, by the way, everything in the text that I'm saying for the woman to do or for the man to do, it's right the opposite. I mean, if I'm saying for a woman to do this, I'm also saying for the man to do this. If I'm saying for the wife to do this, I'm also saying for the husband to do this. But be personal with praise. What did Solomon do? Well, I think there's a couple things he did. Number one, tell her she's loved. Tell her she's loved. Look what verse 9 says. It says, I have compared thee, get this, oh my love. Do you realize? Oh my love. If you study the Song of Solomon, 9 times he refers to her as oh my love. Simple. Tell her she's loved. Simple. Tell him he's loved. Folks, there's a lot of creative ways you can do it. And I don't think it matters so much how you do it. I think it's just so important that you do it. Amen? I don't think it's so. There's a lot of ways you can do it. You say, Pastor, this is simple. Yes, but a lot of people hadn't got it. It's simple, but a lot of people hadn't got it. Solomon did it 9 times, hoping we'd get it. Amen? Tell her she's loved. You can use all kind of ways. This may sound corny, but if sometimes when I'm with Barbara and I'll take her hand, I'll squeeze it 3 times. That means I love you. And she squeezes mine back twice. You know what that means? Me too. Just look for creative ways to do it. I used to travel and preach, and I'd leave all these corny notes. And I remember I'd be gone, and I'd leave a note in the refrigerator. This is true stories. I can't believe we're listening to this guy. But I'd leave a note in the refrigerator, and this is what the note would say. It's cold in here, but my heart burns for you. I'm just saying, whatever you do, tell her she's loved. Tell him that he's loved. Now, I thought about this as we go back to verse 9. Look what it says. It says, I have compared thee, O my love. Wait, I don't know if I'd try this. To a company of horses. I have compared thee, O my love, to a company of horses. But I had to do some research and I found something. If you study 1 Kings chapter 10, verse 26 through 29, Solomon was a very wealthy man. He had 1,400 chariots. He had 12,000 horses. And out front, there was a boss mare. Of all the horses, of all the 12,000, there was a boss mare out front. And what he was saying to her, honey, you're my boss mare out front. You're my boss mare out front. There's nobody like you. This is just a thought, but I believe this. I believe for the most part, men, if we'll treat them like a thoroughbred, we probably won't end up with a nag, amen? Husbands, love your wives, Ephesians 5 and 25 says. This is what I'd say to the husbands and the wives. This is what I'd say. A bell's not a bell till you ring it. A song's not a song until you sing it. Love's not put in your heart to stay. It's not love until you give it away. Tell her, tell him that she's loved. Now, there's a second thing that Solomon teaches us. And not only does Solomon teach us this, but Stevie Wonder teaches us this. Don't act like you've never heard that song. He said there's a second thing we need to do. Not only tell her she's loved, but tell her she's lovely. Tell her she's lovely. Now he gets into that. Let me make this statement. What a woman wears does matter. I ran across this. It says, do you know that when a woman wears a leather dress, a man's heart beats quicker. His throat gets dry. He gets weak in the knees, and he begins to think irrational. Ever wonder why? Because it smells like a new truck. Now look, a story is more believable if you've got details. So look what verse 9 and verse 10 says. It says, I have compared thee, O my love, to a company of horses in Pharaoh's chariots. Now look, thy cheeks are comely with rows of jewels. Thy neck with chains of gold. Now, leave it right there. He knew what he was doing because horses carried royalty. And you've got to understand, in the boss mare's bridle, there were jewels. And in the boss mare, they would braid the mane with feathers, and they would braid the mane with jewels. And he said, thy cheeks are comely with rows of jewels, and thy neck with chains of gold. What he was saying this. He was saying, not only are you loved, but I want you to know you're lovely. And I want you to know something. The jewelry doesn't make you. You make the jewelry. The jewelry doesn't make you. You make the jewelry. Here's all I'm going to try to say. You want to revolutionize your marriage? Tell her she's loved. Tell her she's lovely. You want to revolutionize your marriage? Tell your husband he's loved. Tell your husband he's appreciated. Tell your husband he's respected. What'd Solomon tell us? He said, I'll tell you what to do. He said, there are some things that you need to do that are very important. He said, you be sure and tell her she's loved. Be personal with praise. But he said there's a second thing, and it's woven into the scripture. He said, go public with praise. Go public with praise. Now look what verse 11 says of the text. We. Now, who is we? We are the daughters of Jerusalem. And what I mean by the daughters of Jerusalem, they were friends of Shulamites. This is not Shulamite speaking. This is not Solomon speaking. But look what they said. We will make the borders of gold with studs of silver. Here's all I want you to see. Apparently, Solomon said it where they could hear it too. Here's just a simple principle. I want to encourage you to go public with praise, because if you will go public with praise, I promise you it will get back to your mate. I promise you it's good preaching. If I promise you, by the way, Vern, come up real close, this will work. If you will go public with praise, here's a news flash, it will get back to her. And if you will go public with praise, it will get back to him. Folks, we should never, you come up real close, we should never make derogatory comments about our mate to somebody else. Get in a counseling session if you need it. But all I want to say, you talk to your mama about him, you and him are going to be over it in no time, but mama's going to be a long time getting over it. Good preaching, Benny! I'm saying go public with praise, brag on your mate to other people. See, here's what I've learned. I wish the church could realize this. I wish church people could realize this. It's wrong for me to be proud of me. Pride's wrong in me. You hear me closely. Pride's wrong in me. It's wrong for me to be proud of me, but it's not wrong for me to be proud of you. It's not wrong for me to be proud of you. And I believe if the church would do a better job of being proud of each other, then people wouldn't struggle so much with pride. See, it's wrong for me to be proud of me, but it's not wrong for me to be proud of Barbara. It's not wrong for you to be proud. It's wrong for you to be proud of you, but it's not wrong for you to be proud of your mate. So go public with praise. Sir Winston Churchill, his wife was Clementine. Clementine. And they asked Sir Winston Churchill. Sir Winston Churchill, he was in a forum one time, and they said, if you could come back as anybody, who would you come back? If you could reincarnate, if you could come back as anybody, who would you come back as in this open forum? He said, oh, I'd come back as Clemmy's second husband. That's why that woman's laughing. I'm just saying to you, be public with praise. And then lastly, be persistent with praise. Be persistent with praise. You say, now, Pastor, I'm really, you know, I'm a man's man. Good, you'll get over it. I'm a man's man, and I'm not into all this mushy stuff that you're talking about today. Well, this is all I'm going to say. This is all I'm going to say. I'm going to just read the verses and let you take it from there. By the way, is it okay if we just stay with the Bible? Nobody gets offended, I hope, if we just stay with what God's Word says. I'm not into all this stuff that preachers preach. Well, look what he says. While the king sitteth at his table, my spikenard sendeth forth the smell thereof. A bundle of myrrh is my well-beloved unto me. He shall lie all night betwixt my breast. I'm not saying anything out of line, but it worked out pretty well for Solomon. Amen? I'm just letting the word of God be the word of God. I'm just trying to preach God's word. That's what God's word says. So be persistent. Be persistent. Two things. Number one, sweet words. John Gottman wrote a book called A Couple's Guide to Communication. And this is what John Gottman said in that book, A Couple's Guide to Communication. He said, what sets married couples apart from strangers is that married couples are far less polite with each other. What sets married couples apart from strangers, they're far less polite with each other. Look what Proverbs 16 and 24 says. Pleasant words are as honeycomb, sweet to the soul and health to the bones. Not only sweet words, but lastly, soft words. Look what the Bible says in Proverbs 15 and 1. A soft answer turneth away wrath. A soft answer turneth away wrath. An old boy from North Georgia went down to Florida on spring break. And they were some Ivy League girls down there. And that old North Georgia boy saw those Ivy League school girls, and he said to those girls, Where do you all go to school? They said, Yale. He said, where do you all go to school? I've just been married 36 years. And not much gets accomplished when we yell. Voices go up, volume goes up, communication goes down. Hot heads and cold hearts don't solve anything. As long as we're trying to fix blame, we usually don't fix problems. So what's the secret? We got to stroke more than we poke. We got to brag more than we nag. We got to cheer more than we jeer. Screamers, steamers, schemers, it don't work. It's not the answer. The answer is trying your best to see the best in your mate. The answer is trying to change your communication. The answer is trying to look for positive things in your mate. That's the answer. Because if you go against God's grain, you're going to get splinters. That's all I'm going to say. I've told this story a bunch of times and I'm done. I pastored my second church. I left that church for health reasons. Some of the deacons got sick of me. As a young preacher, I go to a funeral home one night. The man says to me, after everybody leaves, will you stay? It was his wife had died. I said, I sure will. I sure will. Everybody left. We walked back in a room and he said, I want to ask you something, preacher. I said, ask me anything you want to. He said, that's my wife up there. I said, I know that. He said, you know, preacher, I never did tell her I loved her much. Never was real kind to her. Never was. But he said, I want to ask you something. He was an old timer. He said, you've studied that good book, hadn't you? I said, I've studied a little bit. He said, I don't know if this answer's in the good book. But he said, preacher, if me and you walked up there and looked in that casket, I told her I loved her. Can't you hear me? I said, friend, I don't know. But I'll tell you this much. It's sure worth a try. It's sure worth a try. I'll tell you something. I don't want to be that guy. I don't want to be that guy. No, I'll bury pride. I don't want to be that guy. You don't want to be that guy, and you don't want to be that lady. Time to do it's now. Time to express appreciation is now. Time to let them know we love them is now. Time to let them know we love them is now. Theodore Hesburgh said the greatest thing a man or woman can do for their children is love their mate. What's the greatest thing you can do for your children? Love your mate. Say, I want to do something for my children. Love your mate. Love your mate. It's the greatest thing you can do for your children.